Very good morning, students. Today we are going to start with our new topic of general knowledge, that is Indian history. Indian history is classified as ancient history, medieval history, and freedom struggle. Let us know more about the ancient history. India's history and culture is dynamic, spanning back to the beginning of human civilization. It begins with a mysterious culture along the Indus River and in farming communities in the southern lands of India. The history of India is punctuated by constant integration of migrating people with the diverse cultures that surround India. Available evidences suggest that the use of iron, copper, and other metals was widely prevalent in the Indian subcontinent at a fairly early period, which is indicative of the progress that this part of the world has made. By the end of the 4th millennium BC, India had emerged as a region of highly developed civilization. Under the ancient history, we are going to discuss about the Indus Valley Civilization, Vedic Civilization, the Buddhist era, Alexander's invasion, Gupta dynasty, and Harshavardhana. Let us begin our discussion with the Indus Valley Civilization. The history of India begins with the birth of the Indus Valley Civilization, more precisely known as Harappan Civilization. It flourished around 2500 BC in the western part of South Asia, what today is Pakistan and Western India. The Indus Valley was home to the largest of the four ancient urban civilizations of Egypt, Mesopotamia, India, and China. Nothing was known about this civilization till 1920s, when the Archaeological Department of India carried out excavations in the Indus Valley, wherein the ruins of the two old cities, which is Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa, were unearthed. The ruins of the buildings and other things like household articles, weapons of war, gold and silver ornaments, seals, toys, pottery wares, etc., were shown that some 4 to 5,000 years ago, a highly developed civilization flourished in this region. The Indus Valley Civilization was basically an urban civilization, and the people lived in the well-planned and well-built towns, which were also the centers for trade. The ruins of the Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa show that these were magnificent merchant cities which were well-planned, sick, and scientifically laid and well looked after. They had wide roads and a well-developed drainage system. The houses were made of baked bricks and had two to more stories. The highly civilized Harappan knew that the art of growing cereals and wheat and barley constituted their staple food. They consumed vegetables and fruits and ate mutton, pork, and eggs as well. Evidences also show that they wore cotton as well as woolen garments. By 1500 BC, the Harappan culture came to an end. Among various causes ascribed to the decay of Indus Valley civilization are the recurrent floods and other natural causes like earthquake, etc. Very good morning, students. We started our discussion in the previous video from the brief introduction of the ancient history and about the Indus Valley civilization. Let us discuss about the Vedic civilization and the Buddhist era. The Vedic civilization. The Vedic civilization is the earliest civilization in the history of ancient India. It is named after the Vedas, the early literature of the Hindu people. The Vedic civilization flourished along the river Saraswati in a region that now consists of the modern Indian states of Haryana and Punjab. Vedic is synonymous with Hinduism, which is another name for religious and spiritual thought that has evolved from the Vedas. The Ramayana and Mahabharata were the two great epics of this period. The Buddhist era. During the lifetime of Lord Gautam Buddha, 16 great powers, Mahajanapadas, existed in the 7th and the early 6th centuries BC. Among the more important republics were the Sakyas of Kapilavastu and the Lichchavis of Vaishali. Besides the republics, there were monarchical states, among which the important ones were the Kaushambi, that is Vatsa, Magadha, Kosala, and Avanti. These states were ruled by vigorous personalities who had embarked upon the policies of the disentment and absorption of the neighboring states. However, there were distinct signs of the republican states, while those under the monarchs were expanding. Buddha was born in BC 560 and died at the age of 80 in BC 480. The place of his birth was a grove known as Lumbini, near the city of Kapilavastu at the foot of the Mount Palpa in the Himalayan ranges within Nepal. Buddha, whose original name was Siddhartha Gautama, was the founder of Buddhism, the religion and the philosophical system that evolved into a great culture throughout much of the southern and eastern Asia. Very good morning, students. In the previous videos, we discussed about ancient history. Under that, we discussed the Indus Valley civilization, the Vedic civilization, and the Buddhist era. In this video, we are going to discuss about the Alexander's invasion. Under that, we will also discuss about the Mauryan Empire and the end of the Mauryan Empire. Alexander's invasion. In 326 BC, Alexander invaded India. After crossing the river Indus, he advanced towards Takshila. He then challenged King Porus, the ruler of the kingdom between the rivers Jhelum and Chenab. The Indians were defeated in the fierce battle, even though they fought with elephants, which the Macedonians had never before seen. Alexander captured Porus, and like the other local rulers he had defeated, allowed him to continue to govern his territory. During this trip to rivers, the Indus in the south, the Alexander sought out the Indian philosophers, the Brahmins, who were famous for their wisdom, and debated with them on philosophical issues. He became legendary for centuries in India for being both a wise philosopher and a fearless conqueror. One of the villages in which the army halted belonged to the Malis, who were said to be one of the most warlike of the Indian tribes. Alexander was wounded several times in this attack. More seriously, when an arrow pierced his breastplate and his ribcage, the Macedonian officers rescued him in a narrow escape from the village. Alexander and his army reached the mouth of the Indus in July 325 BC and turned westward for home. The Mauryan Empire. The period of the Mauryan Empire marked a new epoch in the history of India. It is said to be a period when chronology became definite. It was a period when politics, arts, trade, and commerce elevated India to a glorious height. It was a period of unification of the territories which lay as fragmented kingdoms. Moreover, Indian contact with the outside world was established effectively during this period. The confusion following the death of Alexander gave Chandragupta Maurya an opportunity to liberate the countries from the yoke of the Greeks and thus occupy the provinces of Punjab and Sindh. He later overthrew the power of Nandas at Magadha with the aid of Kautilya and founded a glorious Mauryan Empire in 322 BC. Chandragupta, who ruled from 324 to 301 BC, thus earned the title of liberator and the first emperor of Bharat. At the higher age, Chandragupta got interested in religion and left his throne to his son Bindusar in 301 BC. Bindusar conquered the highland of Deccan during his reign of 28 years and gave his throne to his son Ashoka in 273 BC. Ashoka emerged not only as the most famous king of the Maurya dynasty, but is also regarded as one of the greatest kings of India and the world. His empire covered the whole territory from Hindu Kush to Bengal and extended over Afghanistan, Baluchistan, and the whole of India with the exception of a small area in the farthest south. The valleys of Nepal and Kashmir were also included in his empire. The most important event of Ashoka's reign was the conquest of Kalinga, the modern Odisha, which proved to be the turning point of his life. The Kalinga War witnessed terrible manslaughter and destruction. The sufferings and atrocities of the battlefield in the heart of Ashoka, his made a resolve not to wage war anymore. He realized the wickedness of worldly conquest and the beauty of moral and spiritual truth. He was drawn to the teachings of Buddha and devoted his life to the conquest of man's heart by the law of duty or pity. He evolved a policy of Dharma Vijay, conquest by pity. Here we can see the end of the Mauryan Empire when Ashoka was succeeded by weak rulers which encouraged the provinces to proclaim their independence. Here the task of administering such a vast empire could not be executed by the weak rulers, and the mutual quarrel among the successors also contributed to the decline of the Mughal Empire. In the beginning of the 1st century AD, the Kushanas established their authority over the northwest frontier of India, and the most famous among the Kushana kings were the Kanishka, who was the third in the Kushana dynasty. The Kushana ruled continued till the middle of the 3rd century AD, and the most notable achievement of their rule was the development of Gandhara school of art and further spread of Buddhism into distant regions of Asia. Very good morning, students. In the previous video, we discuss about Alexander's invasion. In this video, we are going to discuss about Gupta dynasty. After the Kushanas, the Guptas were the most important dynasty. The Gupta period has been described as the golden age of the Indian history. The first famous king of the Gupta dynasty was Ghatotkach's son Chandragupta I. He married Kumara Devi, the daughter of the chief of the Lichhavis. This marriage was a turning point in the life of Chandragupta I. He got Pataliputra in the dowry from the Lichhavis. And from Pataliputra, he laid the foundation of his empire and started conquering many neighboring states with the help of the Lichhavis. He ruled over Magadha in Bihar, Prayaga and Saketa in eastern Uttar Pradesh. His kingdom extended from the river Ganges to Allahabad. Chandragupta I also got the title of Maharajadi Raja, the kings of kings, and ruled about 15 years. Chandragupta I was succeeded by Samudragupta in about 330 AD, who reigned for about 50 years. He was a great military genius and is said to have commanded a military campaign across the Deccan and also subdued the forest tribes of the Vindhya region. Samudragupta's successor Chandragupta II, also known as Vikramaditya, conquered the extensive territories of Malwa, Gujarat and Kathiawar. This provided exceptional wealth which added to the prosperity of the Guptas. The Guptas in this period engaged in sea trade with the countries of the West. It was most probably during his reign that Kalidas, the greatest Sanskrit poet and dramatist, as well as many other scientists and scholars, flourished. Decline of Gupta dynasty. The decline of the Gupta power in northern India between the close of 5th and 6th century AD, which gave rise to various small independent kingdoms and attracted foreign invasions of Huns. Toramara was the leader of the Huns and was successful in annexing large parts of the Gupta Empire. His son Mihirakula was a cruel barbarian and one of the worst person known. Two native powerful princes, the Yashodharaman of Malwa and Baladitya of Magadha, crushed his power and put an end to his reign in India. Very good morning, students. In our previous videos, we were discussing about the Indian history, which is divided into three different forms: ancient history, medieval history and freedom struggle. Ancient history, under which we discussed about the Indus Valley civilization, Vedic civilization, the Buddhist era, Alexander's invasion and Gupta dynasty. Let's discuss the last dynasty in ancient history, that is Harshvardhana. With the commencement of the 7th century, Harshvardhana ascended the throne of Thaneshwar and Kannauj on the death of his brother Rajyavardhana. By 612, Harshvardhana consolidated his kingdom in northern India. In 620 AD, Harshvardhana invaded the Chalukya kingdom in the Deccan, which was then ruled by Pulkesin II. But the Chalukya's resistance proved tough for the Harshvardhana and he was defeated. Harshvardhana is well known for his religious toleration, able administration, and diplomatic relations. He maintained diplomatic relations with China and sent envoys who exchanged the ideas of Chinese rulers and developed their knowledge about each other. So this is all about the various dynasties in the ancient history. Now let's discuss about the medieval history. Under the medieval history, we are going to discuss various dynasties. For a period that has come to be so strongly associated with the Islamic influence and rule in India, medieval Indian history went for almost three whole centuries under the so-called indigenous rulers that included the Chalukyas, the Pallavas, the Pandas, the Rashtrakutas, the Muslims, and finally the Mughal Empire. The most important dynasty to emerge in the middle of the 9th century was that of the Cholas. The first dynasty in the medieval history is the Pallas. Between 8th and 10th centuries AD, a number of powerful empires dominated in the eastern and northern part of India. The Pala king Dharmapala, the son of Gopala, reigned from the late 8th century AD to early 9th century AD. Nalanda University and Vikramshila University were founded by Dharmapala. The Senas, the another dynasty in the medieval history. After the decline of the Pallas, the Sena dynasty established its rule in Bengal. The founder of the dynasty was Samantasena. The greatest ruler of the dynasty was Vijayasena. He conquered the whole of Bengal and was succeeded by his son Ballal Sena. He reigned peacefully but kept his dominance intact. He was a great scholar and wrote four works, including one on astronomy. The last ruler of his dynasty was Lakshmana Sena, under whose reign the Muslims invaded Bengal and the empire fell. The next dynasty, the Pratihara. The greatest ruler of the Pratihara dynasty was Mihir Bhoja. He recovered Kannauj by 1836 and it renamed the capital of the Pratiharas for almost a century. He built the city Bhojpal, Raja Bhoja and other valiant Gujarat kings faced and defeated many attacks of the Arabs from the west. Between 915 to 918 AD, Kannauj was attacked by Rashtrakuta king, who devastated the city, leading to the weakening of the Pratihara Empire. In 1018, Kannauj, then ruled by Rajapala Pratihara, was sacked by Muhammad of Ghazni. The empire broke into independent Rajput states. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we discussed about the Pallas, the Senas, the Pratiharas as the dynasties in the medieval history. Now let's discuss about the Rashtrakutas, the Chola Empire of the South, and the rise of Islam in South Asia. The Rashtrakutas. This dynasty, which ruled from Karnataka, is illustrious for several reasons. They ruled the territory vaster than that of any other dynasty. They were great patrons of art and literature. The encouragement that several Rashtrakuta kings provided to education and literature is unique, and the religious tolerance exercised by them was exemplary. The Chola Empire of the South. It emerged in the middle of the 9th century AD, covered a large part of the Indian peninsula as well as parts of Sri Lanka and the Maldives Islands. The first important ruler to emerge from the dynasty was Rajaraja Chola I, and his son and the successor Rajendra Chola. Rajaraja carried forward the annexation policy of his father. He led armed expedition to distant lands of Bengal, Odisha and Madhya Pradesh. The successor of Rajendra I, Rajadhiraj and Rajendra II were brave rulers who fought fiercely against the later Chalukya kings, but could not check the decline of Chola Empire. The later Chola kings were weak and incompetent rulers. The Chola Empire thus lingered on for another century and a half, and finally came to an end with the invasion of Malik Kafur in the early 40th century AD. The rise of Islam in South Asia. The initial entry of Islam into South Asia came in the first century after the death of Prophet Muhammad. The Khalifa in Damascus sent an expedition to Balochistan and Sindh in 711, led by Muhammad bin Qasim. He captured Sindh and Multan. 300 years after his death, Sultan Muhammad of Ghazni, the ferocious leader, led a series of raids against Rajput kingdoms and rich Hindu temples as well, and established a base in Punjab for future incursions. In 1024, the Sultan sent out on his last famous expedition to the southern coast of Kathiawar along the Arabian Sea, where he sacked the city of Somnath and its renowned Hindu temple. Very good morning, students. In our previous videos, we discussed about medieval history and the different dynasties in the medieval history, like the Palas, the Senas, the Pratiharas, the Rashtrakutas, the Chola Empire of the South, and the rise of Islam in South Asia. Now today we are going to discuss few more dynasties in the medieval history. Let's begin with Timur's invasion. It was during the reign of the last king of Tughlaq dynasty that the mighty King Timur invaded India in 1398 AD. He crossed Indus and captured Multan and just walked over to Delhi without much resistance. Vijayanagar Empire. When Muhammad Tughlaq was losing his power in Deccan, the two Hindu princes, Harihar and Bukka, founded an independent kingdom in the region between the river Krishna and Tungabhadra in 1336. They soon established their sway over the entire territory between the river Krishna in the north and Kaveri in the south. The rising powers of the Vijayanagar Empire brought it into clash with many powers, and they frequently fought wars with the Bahamani kingdom. Bhakti movement. An important landmark in the cultural history of medieval India was the silent revolution in society brought about by a galaxy of socio-religious reformers, a revolution known as the Bhakti movement. This movement was responsible for many rites and rituals associated with the worship of God by Hindus, Muslims, and Sikhs of Indian subcontinent. For example, Kirtan at Hindu temple, Qawwali at Dargah by Muslims, and singing of Gurbani at Gurudwara are all derived from the Bhakti movement of medieval India. The leader of this Hindu revivalist movement was Shankaracharya, a great thinker and a distinguished philosopher. And this movement was propounded by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Namadeva, Tukaram, Jayadeva. The movement's major achievement was its abolition of idol worship. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we discussed about Timur's invasion, Vijayanagar Empire, and Bhakti movement. Now let's discuss the Mughal Empire and rise of Sikh power. In India, the Mughal Empire was one of the greatest empires ever. The Mughal Empire ruled hundreds of millions of people. India became united under one rule and had very prosperous cultural and political years during the Mughal rule. There were many Muslim and Hindu kingdoms split all throughout India until the founders of the Mughal Empire came. There were some men such as Babur, grandson to the great Asian conqueror Timur, and the conqueror Genghis Khan from the northern region of Ganges, the river valley, who decided to take over Khyber and eventually all of India. Rise of Sikh power. Sikhism was founded by Guru Nanak Dev at the beginning of the 16th century. Guru Nanak was born on April 15, 1469 in the western Punjab village of Talwandi. Even as a child, he was given to deep thinking with no interest in worldly life. At the age of 30, he got enlightenment. Thereafter, he travelled almost the whole of the country and went over to Mecca and Baghdad, preaching his message. On his death, he was followed by 9 other gurus in succession. Very good morning, students. In our previous videos, we discussed about ancient history and medieval history. In this video, first we are going to discuss in brief about the freedom struggle. In ancient times, people from all over the world were keen to come to India. The Persians, followed by the Iranians and Parsis, immigrated to India. Then came the Mughals and they too settled down permanently in India. Genghis Khan, the Mongolian, invaded and looted India many times. Alexander the Great too came to conquer India but went back after a battle with Porus. Hien Sang from China came in pursuit of knowledge and to visit the ancient Indian universities of Nalanda and Takshila. Columbus wanted to come to India, but instead landed on the shores of America. Vasco da Gama from Portugal came to trade his country's goods in Britain for Indian spices. The French came and established their colonies in India. Lastly, the Britishers came and ruled over India for nearly 200 years. After the Battle of Plassey in 1757, the British achieved political power in India, and their paramountcy was established during the tenure of Lord Dalhousie, who became the Governor General in 1848. He annexed Punjab, Peshawar, and the Pathan tribes in the northwest of India. And by 1856, the British conquest and its authority were firmly established. And while the British power gained its heights during the middle of the 19th century, the discontent of the local rulers, the peasantry, the intellectuals, common masses, as also of the soldiers who became unemployed due to the disbanding of the armies of various states that were annexed by the British and became widespread. This soon broke out into a revolt which assumed the dimensions of the 1857 mutiny. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we discussed in brief about freedom struggle. Now, in this video, we are going to talk about the Indian Mutiny of 1857. The conquest of India, which could be said to have begun with the Battle of Plassey in the year 1757, was practically completed by the end of Dalhousie's tenure in 1856. It had been by no means a smooth affair, as the simmering discontent of the people manifested itself in many localized revolt during this period. However, the mutiny of 1857, which began with a revolt of the military soldiers at Meerut, soon became widespread and posed a grave challenge to the British rule. Even though the British succeeded in crushing it within a year, it was certainly a popular revolt in which the Indian rulers, the masses, and the militia participated so enthusiastically that it came to be regarded as the first war of Indian independence. Introduction of zamindari system by the British, where the peasants were ruined through exorbitant charges made from them by the new class of landlords. The craftsmen were destroyed by the influx of the British manufactured goods. The religion and the caste system, which formed the firm foundation of the traditional Indian society, was endangered by the British administration. The Indian soldiers as well as people in administration could not rise in hierarchy, as the senior jobs were reserved for the Europeans. Thus, there was all-round discontent and disgust against the British rule, which burst out in a revolt by the sepoys at Meerut, whose religious sentiments were offended when they were given new cartridges greased with cow and pig fat, whose covering had to be stripped out by biting with the mouth before using them in rifles. The Hindus as well as the Muslim soldiers who refused to use such cartridges were arrested, which resulted in a revolt by their fellow soldiers on 9th May 1857. The rebel forces soon captured Delhi, and the revolt spread to a wider area, and there was uprising in almost all parts of the country. The most ferocious battle were fought in Delhi, Awadh, Rohilakhand, Bundelkhand, Allahabad, Agra, Meerut, and Western Bihar. The rebellious forces under the commands of Kanwar Singh in Bihar and Bhakt Khan in Delhi gave a stunning blow to the British. In Kanpur, Nana Saheb was proclaimed as the Peshwa, and the brave leader Tatya Tope led his troops. Rani Lakshmibai was proclaimed the ruler of Jhansi, who led her troops in the heroic battles with the British. The Hindus, the Muslims, the Sikhs, and all the other brave sons of India fought shoulder to shoulder to throw out the British. The revolt was controlled by the British within 1 year. It began from Meerut on 10th of May 1857 and ended in Gwalior on 20th June 1858. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we discussed about the Indian Mutiny of 1857. Now, in this video, we are going to discuss about the end of the East India Company, the non-cooperation movement, and Quit India movement. End of the British East India Company. Consequent to the failure of the revolt of 1857's rebellion, one also saw the end of the East India Company's rule in India, and many important changes took place in the British government's policy towards India, which sought to strengthen the British rule through winning over the Indian princes, the chiefs and the landlords. Queen Victoria's proclamation of 1st November 1858 declared that thereafter India would be governed by and in the name of the British monarch through a Secretary of State. The non-cooperation movement. The non-cooperation movement was pitched in under the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi and the Indian National Congress from September 1920 to February 1922. Making a new awakening in the Indian independence movement after a series of events including the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, Gandhiji realized that there was no prospect of getting any fair treatment at the hands of British. So he planned to withdraw the nation's cooperation from the British government, thus launching the non-cooperation movement and thereby marrying the administrative setup of the country. This movement was a great success as it got massive encouragement to the million of Indians. This movement almost shook the British authorities. Quit India movement. In August 1942, Gandhiji started the Quit India movement and decided to launch a mass civil disobedience movement. Do or die, call to force the British to leave India. The movement was followed nonetheless by large-scale violence directed at railway stations, telegraph offices, government buildings and other emblems and institutions of colonial rule. There were widespread acts of sabotage, and the government held Gandhi responsible for these acts of violence, suggesting that they were a deliberate act of Congress policy. However, all the prominent leaders were arrested and the Congress was banned and the police and the army were brought out to suppress the movement. Thank you.